land.
Let my people go.
Oppressed so hard they could not stand.
Let my people go.
So the Lord said, go down.
Go down.
Moses.
Moses.
Way down,
down
in Egypt land. Tell old Pharaohs to let my people go.
Let my people go.
So Moses went to Egypt land.
Let my people go.
He made old Pharaoh understand.
Let my people go.
Yes, the Lord said, go down.
Go down.
Moses.
Moses.
Way down in Egypt land. Tell old Pharaohs to let my people go.
Let my people go.
Said,
let my people go.
If not, I'll smite your firstborn dead.
Let my people go.
'Cause the Lord said, go down.
Go down.
Moses.
Moses.
Kudos to whoever is picking the music, I have to say. As I sit here and I'm trying to prepare my mind, it just starts my blood pumping these last few weeks, the songs that we've picked in the beginning. And as I listened to it, I felt how appropriate. Let my people go. You know, it's been an despairing week, I feel. You know, I watch too much news, I listen to too much news when I'm driving around, and have felt some despair. And I do feel like that song makes me think, how do I turn that despair into hope? You know, I think when things look bleak, the opportunity is there to turn that around. So for Kate this week, I think it's going to be turning off the news and turning on the hope. This morning for announcements, first of all, welcome. I don't even know if I said welcome. We are, hopefully you're joining us on Zoom. Please mute your phones if it's not a responsive reading, unmute for responsive readings and mute for hymns and prayers. We do have a few announcements. Many of you may have or will receive a letter in the mail this week about our per capita contribution. And that's kind of Calvary Church's skin in the game, as we say in the corporate world. So the money is paid to the Presbytery. It goes to that big picture services and resources that we do use. So when you see that letter, please return that money, pay the money on behalf of your membership, and know that Calvary has to pay it either way. So you'll see that letter coming in the mail this week. We also have some interest in membership. So far and wide, or local in Newburgh. For lack of a membership class, I think that there's still opportunity to join us, please. We'd love to have you as part of our Calvary community, and you can reach out to Reverend Lewis on his email, or even the friend's email if you're receiving notices about services, certainly if you're on this morning. I think that's it for announcements. You know, we're anxiously awaiting our return to the sanctuary. I think I know I take for granted all that's happening behind the scenes, and there's a lot of work that will still need to be done when major decisions are made. So I just ask you all to keep the fire committee members in your thoughts and minds, and prepare your hands for work, because when the time comes and we're working to get back into the sanctuary, we will count on everybody to help us make that happen. So with that this morning, again, I cheat. I take a deep breath long before I unmute my phone, but I am going to ask again for our Calvary Church to take a deep breath, drop our shoulders, and let us worship God. Blessed are those who have not seen,
and yet have come to believe.
Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for the Lord is good.
God's steadfast love endures forever.
Our first hymn this morning is Just As I Am, Without One Plea.
You bow your heads with me. Lord, we thank you, O God, that you are a forgiving God. You are one who grants us mercy when we ourselves have been merciless. You and you alone consider grace as your first action to our daily missteps in our lives. You have admonished us in your word to seek the forgiveness of those with whom we have discontent. Forgive our debts as we forgive our debtors. Therefore, We come fully knowing that we have left things undone. We come asking that you guide us in healing ways that we may be an example of what you have already fulfilled in our lives. Help us live authentically out of the actions of our faith as opposed to our simple words. We pray these things. Amen. My brothers and sisters, as we travail through this situation in our land and in our lives, sometimes, as Sister Kate has already said, we very often take for granted the comforts that we've always had. And we sometimes are not able to see the things that we've done, particularly to those that we don't like. But nevertheless, God encourages us through his word to love one another. But I can't love you unless I forgive you and move on. Likewise, God pardons us, forgives us for our missteps, and moves on. I encourage you today, no matter what you're going through, no matter what situation, in the vernacular of the street, God has your back. Move on. Forgive. Love one another. This is our pardon. Thanks be to God.
Let us bow our heads. Prepare our hearts, O God, to accept your word. Silence in us any voice but your own, that hearing we may also obey your will, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
My brothers and sisters, our Old Testament lesson is taken from the book of Exodus, the third chapter, verses 1 through 15. Exodus, the third chapter, verses 1 through 15. Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law, Jethro, the priest of Midian. He led his flock beyond the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of a bush. He looked, and the bush was blazing. Yet it was not consumed. Then Moses said, I must turn aside and look at this great sight and see why the bush is not burned up. When the Lord saw that he had turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here I am. Then he said, Come, no closer. Remove the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. He said further, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face,
for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, I have observed the misery of my people who are in Egypt. I've heard their cry on account of their taskmasters. Indeed, I know their sufferings, and I have come down to deliver them from the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land to a good and broad land, a land flowing with milk and honey, to the country of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. The cry of the Israelites has now come to me. I have also seen how Egyptians oppress them. So come, I will send you to Pharaoh to bring my people, the Israelites, out of Egypt. But Moses said to God, who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? He said, I will be with you, and this shall be the sign for you that it is I who sent you. When you have brought the people out of Egypt, you shall worship God on this mountain. But Moses said to God, if I come to the Israelites and say to them, the God of your ancestors has sent me to you, and they ask me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? God said, Moses, I am who I am. And he said further, thus you shall say to the Israelites, I am has sent me to you. God also said to Moses, thus you shall say to the Israelites, the Lord, the God of your ancestors, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this is my title for all generations. May God add a blessing to the reading of this word for the good and edification of our souls.
Thank you.
So this morning we're discovering something about our own lives and the presence of God as we seek to understand the life of Moses as he attempts to lead a people who have been enslaved and have gotten comfortable with being enslaved. Here's a man who, minding his own business with his father-in-law's flock, a Midianite priest on a mountain. And at that time, we hear of this man who was a fugitive from justice. He was one who had already killed an Egyptian for his belief of that taskmaster abusing an Israelite. We don't really want to get into the weeds with who was right or who was wrong, but we want to examine the man of Moses and how that man applies to your and my situation today. There he was, not expecting to do anything but tend the sheep, but he had what theologians called an epiphany, a theological event, theophany, that captured his attention, and it was a burning bush. It is my belief, my brothers and sisters, as we look at this scripture, and I think that many people have heard about the story, the context of Moses as he is moving through the history of the Bible. You know, he was abandoned as a child because of an edict of a Pharaoh who said that all Hebrew boys, babies, should be killed because, according to the scripture, the Egyptian Pharaoh at that time feared the growth and abundance of those who were enslaved. Not an unusual realization. People who have some question of power and authority, when they see those who are laboring for them rising up and being vocal about their oppression, it is no wonder that we saw the dynamics of Moses and those who were enslaved. When I think of Moses, I think of our own Moses, Harriet Tubman. She was quoted as having said that she could have freed more slaves if they had realized that they were free. Sometimes our freedom comes at a cost, and those of us who experience that fullness of freedom, I believe, come through a theophany experience of our own. For Moses, it was the burning bush. Sometimes it is the struggle that we face that somehow God gets our attention. Have you ever been in a situation where you were struggling so long and then all of a sudden God got your attention? It may not have been a burning bush. It may have been a conversation. It may have been a word. It may have been a person. It may have been a picture. It may have been walking in the woods. It could have been fishing somewhere. That God's revealing evidence of his presence came directly to you. The burning bush is simply put, in my opinion, as the presence of God. And when Moses was able to see the burning bush, the Bible says he turned aside. He just did not ignore it. How many times have you and I ignored our own burning bushes and just hoped that they would kind of go away? I'm suggesting today that as we are going through this situation in our lives, that God is giving us, each and every one of us, our own theophany experience. And in doing so, God is inviting us in that experience to seek the presence of the divine. Why is that important? Well, it is important because it is in our search for God's presence in our lives that we find some sense of settlement some sense of peace, some sense of joy. The scripture is loaded with verses of the Bible that talk about seeking God's presence. Jesus even says in Matthew, but seek first the kingdom of God and God's righteousness, and all things will be added to you. It is about seeking the presence of God. It may have been a burning bush for Moses, but it was the presence of God that brought him to the place of leadership. Sometimes what we're going through, we are kind of laboring and struggling trying to discern what it is God is saying. It seems to me that the theophany experience also, the burning bush experience also indicates a kind of proving ground for our sense of purpose. Because without a sense of purpose, we are stuck in the struggle. Now, the scripture says very clearly, where Moses is confronted, or the reality of God, the presence of God, is brought more to his attention on that mountain, it says, come no closer. Verse 5, third chapter, he said, come no closer, remove the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. As you know, we're all struggling trying to get back to church. And sometimes we think that the church is the only place where God's presence is. But thanks be to God, God is where I pursue his love and his grace. Now, I've always hated this phrase, I don't have to go to church to worship God, I can worship God in my home. Yeah, I've heard that. But in the midst of a pandemic, now you got what you wanted, an opportunity to worship God in your house. But you know, there is something about finding God where you are that is a very challenging experience today. The scripture says, the place where you are standing is holy ground. Think about that for a moment. The place, repeat after me, the place where you're standing is holy ground. Think about it for a moment. I'm going through something right now. I don't even know whether I'll have money to pay all my bills. The place where you are standing is holy ground. I don't know about my children. I don't know about my mom or my dad who's struggling in this sense of isolation. I got folks in the hospital sick and troubled. The place you are standing is holy ground. I wonder what prohibits us to find the presence of God in the midst of our circumstances. Could it be for Moses, it was God told him, take off your shoes. Sometimes we just have to feel the earth under which we stand, where we stand. We're taking away all barriers that disconnect us from the divine. I don't know about you, but this period of time in my life, I've had a lot of questions and a lot of doubts. Paul Tillich once said, doubt is the underbelly of faith. And it is through these doubts that I want to encourage you that even if you're doubting, this place you're standing is holy ground. How can I give thanks for all the things that God has brought me? I thank God by realizing that it was God alone who brought me through the storm. Why? Because this place you're standing is holy ground. Amen.
Brothers and sisters, we're standing on holy ground, the place where we are right now. What a blessing we have in knowing that God is present in our lives. It's a wonderful thing to have this opportunity to use this different kind of platform to embrace one another. Let us pass our peace by unmuting our mics, saying hello, embracing each other virtually. May the peace of Christ be with you.
Now,
be with you.
Peace, everyone.
Good morning. Wonderful sermon, Reverend Lewis.
Yes, very Indeed. Fulfilling service.
Yes, I'm
grateful for everybody's presence. Thank you, Kate.
Peace, Joe. Martha.
Peace, John. Peace, Joe.
Peace, Joe.
And for all of those folks who,
peace
are,
to you.
Who are with us across the boundaries of New York, peace of the Lord be with you as well.
Peace be with you, Erica.
Peace be with you, too. Good morning. Good to see you.
Erica.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning, Marlene.
Good morning, Kate. Good morning, Jim.
Good morning, Marlene.
Good morning.
Every week we get more people in our church.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Good morning, Peg.
And Roy.
And Roy, yep. Yeah.
All right, we're going to proceed now to mute your mics, and we're going to proceed with Mr. Ferguson. Mr. Ferguson.
Prayers, Jake.
Let us bow our heads. Thank you, John. Are there any prayer concerns this morning?
Prayers for the Grieco family, passing of Mike Grieco, who was very well known in the city of Newburgh, younger than me, leaves many family and friends behind.
For the Grieco family.
Our granddaughter, Jenna, who's at the Harvard Law School, she's showing many symptoms of the COVID, and yet she keeps testing negative, and they don't know exactly what's happening. Secondly, the relationship with our son sometimes can be difficult, as some of us know. And thirdly, I'm preaching for the first time in a long time next Sunday at Scotchtown, and would covet your prayers for that too.
For family and for new ministries and the comforts of holy ground. Any other prayer concerns?
Roy Plaws at the VA hospital for his operation.
Roy Plaws, who's at the VA. For Ray Strakosch and Doris Strakosch as they transition to another level of living.
For all the students who are returning to school, all the teachers, because they have new challenges in front of them, that God just give them the wisdom that they need to be successful in their tasks to educate, and that the children are successful in their learning.
Amen.
Happy birthday prayers for Carter, who turns 10 today, and Noah, whose birthday it is today as well. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
Double digits.
Go ahead. I want to celebrate the 100th birthday of one friend, and the 101 birthday of another friend, Dr. Thelma Adair, who was former moderator of the church, turned 100 years old yesterday. And a dear friend of ours, the mother of Dr. John Yassin, turned 101 a week ago. We celebrate their lives and God's grace in their lives.
Thelma, was that your installation, I remember?
Yeah, she was at the installation service.
Yeah.
Yeah. What wasn't quite 100 years ago, but it was close.
Long enough.
Keep your prayers, please, going for our granddaughters, but particularly Anastasia.
Yeah.
Thinking of her.
As she deals with her life and our lives as well. So we're living in perilous times. Emotionally, there's a tremendous amount of solitude and depression going on. But we serve a God who's able to reach us, whether we make our bed in hell or we have, like the sparrow on the rooftop, a home. God is our friend. Won't you bow your heads with me? Merciful God, we're grateful for all the things that you do for us that we cannot see. We're grateful for the things that you provide for us that we cannot provide for ourselves. We're grateful for the people in our lives and the struggles that we have with them. We're grateful for, were it not for your presence and this holy ground experience that you give us, we would not know that our feet are really grounded in your spirit. We ask you, Lord, that as we bow our heads and humble our hearts, that you remember those whose names we've called, whose situations in life we've named, that in any way that we can, and as humbly as we can, be the living letters of grace and mercy to those, as you have been a living spirit of grace and mercy in our own lives. We're mindful, O Lord, of the words of our Lord and Savior, who taught us to pray together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Jim Ferguson here at our time of offering. And Kate, in her opening statement, mentioned hope. And I'd like to take a couple minutes and share a story of hope with you. If we make it through December, everything will be fine, is the first and last lines of a song by country music singer Merle Haggard. A song about a factory worker who loses his job. And his little girl asks why she won't be getting a gift that Christmas. This song reminds me of the Project Life Christmas party hosted in our fellowship hall every December. Project Life is a shelter in Newburgh where abused and abandoned mothers and children are given hope for a better life. Our longtime member, Ray Strakosch, has served on their board for many years. Thank you, Ray. It also reminds me of the one or two needy families, our deacons and members adapt each December to provide gifts or in the hope of making their Christmas a bit merrier. Like the little girl in Merle's song, perhaps the children were wondering if they were getting a gift at Christmas. These December mission projects are made possible by our faithful offerings. And with the current challenges at Calvary, I have the same hope as the factory worker in Merle's song, that if we make it through December, everything will be fine. Amen. Our offering hymn today is Be Thou My Vision, as performed by Joseph Bush. Consider ourselves standing for the doxology, prayer of dedication, and our closing hymn. Please join me in the prayer dedication. You have given us the greatest gift of all, Jesus Christ, your Son, our Savior. In gratitude, we return to you a portion of what you have given us to serve you here and around this world. Amen. Our closing hymn, How Great is Thy Faithfulness.
The place in which we stand is holy ground. And what a wonderful closing hymn, morning by morning, new mercies we see. All that we've needed, God's hand has provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. As we leave this worship, know that God never leaves our presence. And if we pursue God's presence daily in our lives, we will find ultimately the peace and the joy that surpasses all of our understanding. And now may the grace of God, the sweet communion of God's Holy Spirit, whom we love, both now and forevermore, let every heart say, amen. Amen. Go in peace.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Love that hymn.
Yeah. Amen.
So we'll give us a few moments. We'll go directly into coffee hour. We want to thank all of those who are there. Sing with me.
Amazing grace, how sweet a sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see.
Praise God, come on. Grace of God and the sweet communion of God's Holy Spirit rest, rule, abide with us and those whom we love, both now and forevermore. Amen.
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 Amen.